Hermana, ¿cómo me cuente no me acuñaba que te hago? Pucate te muana no ya aquí va. ¿Cómo no te tipo no fare? ¿Cómo no te iba? ¿Cómo no te tipo digo coraca para que te hape? ¿Cómo se me hana a ocuengo a tu tai? ¿En qué hiciste no hasta ahora? ¿Namo que pona o tai potegi? ¿Nanti me camo ya que te aquí a eri o a night va a venir a agua con nanti irakiru? Engari, aku sedang pitama, aku ingin wa nanai, kami di mana, ki di mana fino wa tenai rohi, aku nak kami ka o nanti rohi hiki hiki, kami di mana ki aku kaita itu nanti fino wa. Kiri Ren, that's all a bit flash and a bit posh, isn't it, the way Gillian introduces you. If you know me, you'll know that I was schooled at Wairau College, and probably posh is a kind of a word that is used to discuss a Wairau College graduate. So, yeah, rock. So I'm just going to go really quickly, because I know there's a lot of wonderful people who want to talk to you about a lot of wonderful things that I don't want to hog the time. So, I want to acknowledge, actually, Professor Graham Smith, who probably doesn't remember me because I was like a little 18-year-old scooting around the sides of his and Linda's office back in the day at the University of Auckland. But some things really stood out to me that Graham raised on the very first day of this conference, and I wanted to raise them again. He identified about and he laid down some challenges for us as Indigenous educators, and I want to really kind of re-emphasise those this morning. He identified about the collective responsibility that we have as Indigenous educators to mobilise our individual behaviours into a collective Māori good. It might not be word for word, but that's what I think he said. He also noted, and I really like this, a new term I hadn't thought of, that privatised behaviours which promote anti-collegial relationships often deviate rather than support our Māori environment and also Māori advancement. And that these collective responsibilities are related to whakapapa, whānau, iwi, kawa and tikanga. And perhaps I'd also add, because I don't live in my own rohe, kaupapa. And he challenged us that if we really were serious about that we needed to get more intentional about our change, and argued that some of us are more part of the system as opposed to being responsible for our own social responsibilities. Isn't that a great question, sorry, as a psychologist, for self-reflection? Do we think in our jobs, whether it's in a tertiary education, and I've also met some wonderful school teachers while I've been here also, do we use as a self-reflection tool the comment, am I colonised by my academy, or am I decolonising my academy? Have you thought about that? It's quite a complex question, but I'm sure there's times that we think, is our lens becoming more lighter in colour the longer we stay in this academic environment, or are we browning up the environment? And it's really hard sometimes to tell. When I go home back to Nuhaka, well, first thing I get is, gee, why do you bring your posh Christchurch accent back here? And at that time I think, jinx, maybe I am whitening up my lens, and they seemingly, because I don't have a PhD in fried bread, I'm back to the kitchen to do dishes where I belong. But what I really think Professor Smith was sharing with us is a really important question, which is, do we think we're the only Māori in the village? And I think sometimes, and I know Aroha Mai that you might be at the moment, Simon, but being only Māori in the village is actually not a good lens for us to use, and it's a really unsafe place to be. And when we think we're the only Māori in the village, it also means that we forget about something that I really took away from your talk, Graham, which was our role and the importance of social responsibility, and more than social responsibility, our role and our need to remember our social accountability. Not just to our whānau and to our hapū and to our iwi, but actually this is a really big taki, but to all Māori, because not all Māori look like me, or you, or anyone else in your whānau. And I really don't like this discourse around, you know, how Māori used to be and now we're all diverse. I come from Te Tai Rāwhiti. Trust me, those of us from Kahananu don't think we're a thing like the cousins up the road, 40 minutes, rongo whakata. And holy hell, what an insult, sorry Graham, if you think that we have a nice pro. We've always had diversity. And in our traditional model, social accountability to each other was so important. My tūpuna, Rā Kai Pāka, he got into a hell of a lot of trouble up in Ngāti Porou. They kicked him out. But social accountability is his father, Kahakurunu, went, oh, that wasn't a very big OE, you better come back to Nuhaka and stay here and behave yourself. So social accountability has always been important, and we have always been diverse. But how does this apply to us in our, as Indigenous educators? And that's what I quickly want to talk to you about today. So thanks to Ariki Designs, when I used to have pretty paru PowerPoints, this is what Hori can do for you. Just doing a punch there, Hori. For those of us at the University of Otago, within the Hauora Māori curriculum, and I acknowledge my colleague here, Joe Baxter, who's been, this has been a very long journey for us, this to us is part of and how we show our students their journey in Hauora Māori. That they start off with Joe here in year one, and when they hit year four, they get divvied between Dunedin, Christchurch and Wellington. So we have three different clinical medical schools where we take them to this part of the journey, and then the rest is their lifelong journey. But what we try to get our students to envision is actually that the kaupapa for Hauora Māori is for them to get on this waka and assist our whānau to Hauora. This island here is symbolic of Hauora. So we've got all these flash ideas. We teach them the hui process, which is a, again, Ariki Designs made my PowerPoint look a bit flashier than it really is, but it's really, this makes perfect sense to all of you around how we engage with Māori patients. We then developed the Meihana model, which enabled our students to understand a framework by which they should be working with Māori patients, which isn't just about what they see, but also the impact of things like colonisation, racism, migration, marginalisation, and also understanding really key elements of te ao Māori, including āhua, which for us means personalised indicators, so everybody doesn't have, especially my whanau, Whanauka from Naitau don't all have rock East Coast tan like I do, but also about whenua, tikanga and whānau. So we teach this framework, and so we thought, gee, we're pretty good. Actually, in all my evaluations I've done internationally, the University of Otago has got one of the most comprehensive frameworks of teaching Indigenous health. And then we're even flasher. We have this thing you all know about, constructive alignment. Just love that word, just sounds so posh. But really it means that you justify to the institution who's paying you money that you know what you're teaching, you think you know how you're teaching it, and then you're going to check whether the students know whether you taught it the way you think you did. And so this is all really, really cool. But is this social accountability? And how do we know it's socially accountable? And who are we supposed to be socially accountable to when we live in an institution and the man's paying us? Well, the truth is, this is actually a very, very complicated, really, really complicated situation. And I'm sure a lot of you have pondered it. Who are you socially accountable to? How do you determine whether you are socially accountable? Back to your institution, is it? I mean, is it based on our performance appraisals? Is it when you go home that your accent isn't a posh Christchurch accent and your whānau still want you to, or are going to allow you to graduate to doing the fry bread? Like, how do we know that we're socially accountable and on the button? How do we know that we're not losing essentially who we are by being Indigenous educators to mainly non-Indigenous students? Although, thanks to all Joe's hard work, the number of Indigenous students are growing within our cohort. What I want to share with you today is some research findings based on really my PhD, but also a system that at the end, within our Hauora Māori units that we put in place to understand really a level of social accountability. So if you think about the curriculum as your product, I like to think of it as a really good chicken and avocado burger. And if we think about the curriculum we produce as this really good, or we hope it's good, chicken and avocado burger, who do we ask whether it's good, whether it's quality, and whether it makes a difference? Within our curriculum, these are the cohorts, I'm not sure if you can see that probably, but these are the cohorts who we determine our social accountability. One is the students. Unfortunately, they pay money, and so the university says we have to respect them. But also, they are truly, if we want to make a difference in Māori health, our students are our agents of change. So I have an invested interest to produce good graduates because of social accountability. We've all had enough bad whānau stories, right? Of when people have been in the system, they've had a lot of racist experiences. I don't want to produce a graduate that continues to give that type of impression of the medical profession. So actually the students are accountable, and I'm accountable to them, and I'm accountable to you for what I produce. Then we have our patients. Now what I think is interesting about social accountability is my really, really flash boss, what he'd like to do is put some really friendly Māori around a table, and he'd like to go, how are you today? This is what we're doing, is that okay to you? And he'd really like it to be Nani Rangi and Papa Alf. That's who he'd really like at their table, because it's safe and secure, and for a long time, that's what our institutions have got away with. The dialakoma to it is their social accountability. But actually in our curriculum, we go, what about the patients we're exposed? We're exposing them to our students. And worse, our colleagues, who we have less control over. What? How do they feel? How do we determine whether we're socially accountable to them? How do I know that the meihana wāno and hui process is acceptable to them? How do I know that? They have to be a link in the social accountability train. And it can't be, sorry, I love Nani Rangi and Papa Alf, but it can't be about them. It's got to be about the very Māori patients in which our students are interacting. Then we've got our Māori health stakeholders. If our Māori health workers at Christchurch Hospital think I suck, then I suck. I have to own that. How do I connect in with our Māori health stakeholders? So again, this isn't Nani Rangi and Papa Alf. How do I work with my colleagues in the health system, and how do they determine and give me feedback that I'm doing okay or that I suck? And they're really good at telling me both. Then what about my Māori health, the Māori health teaching team? Those that I work with that are both Māori and non-Māori, but that are committed to this kaupapa, and those that are not just based in Christchurch, but also in Dunedin and in Wellington. And then sometimes when we play with our cousins from Auckland University, who we all know and went to uni with anyway, so they're just your mates, but how do we be accountable to each other about, again, not being the only Māori in the village? If Joe disagrees with something I'm teaching, what are our mechanisms? And how do we keep each other in check for when we are just going a little bit rogue and forgetting what the kaupapa is? Because sometimes people can inflate us that we think we're better than we are, and actually we need our peers to clip our wings. I don't care if you bring an associate professor. Get back in the kitchen, do the dishes. It's really, really important to keep the social agenda on the open. Then we have our conveners. Conveners is kind of our way that we talk about the leadership that in the medical curriculum. So what are my colleagues saying? How are they being impacted by this curriculum? Are they having any impact? They teach the same students as I do. What does that mean? What's the impact? And then the last stakeholders, as I've called it, systemic stakeholders, but really it's my boss and his mates and the senior management team. Do they even know what I do? Other than have to rock out of Waiata when the kaumātua makes me at the graduation ceremony? Do they know what else I do? And how are they being impacted by what I teach? And how do I market it so that they understand social accountability? So let's start with students, and I've got 5 wonderful volunteers from the audience. It's all right, they know who they are, who are actually going to give you some direct quotes from what our students said. So if I can get you to yell really loud, and we'll start with student one.
I didn't realise Māori people still went to Marae and their cultural practices in real life. I thought that only happened on television and the movies.
Now that might be quite astounding to some of you, but when the students come into Joe and I, they come from a very diverse range of settings. And that quote was not said in 1980, it was said in 2002. And their trip to the marae freaked them out that they still existed other than on buoy or on whale rider. Student two.
I never really thought about issues like colonisation so deeply like this before. It really challenged my thoughts, ideas, even though I am from a highly Māori populated area.
Kia ora.
Experiencing the Māori culture by being at the marae is a very effective way of getting an understanding. This is so much better than just having a lecture in school. Just staying in the marae made me feel the culture.
The class involved in the Hauora Māori Day reported that the event provided one of the best clinical experiences of the medical course to date. We felt that the day was incredibly valuable in allowing students to develop and apply Hauora Māori skills in a Māori-focused practical setting. In addition to the healthcare experience that this event provided, the fifth year class also loved being part of something in which they were contributing positively to people's health. Medical students often feel like they are a burden to the medical system. The Hauora Māori Day was empowering and made us feel useful.
So our students at the end of their fifth year go and do free Hauora Māori screenings within the community, and that comment was related to that.
He goes to me, I'm going to tell you something. It's not just because you are Māori. I absolutely love the Māori health stuff. He never ever thought it was important before he got into medical school. He said that he just had a negative view of Māori, and as he went through this course, his perception of Māori has changed so much, and he really can't wait to get out there and make a difference.
And so there's been some students that have had heaps of resistance, who we're pulling in them out of their colonised lens, and it's highly uncomfortable. And there's other students that are hitting the ground running and really excited that when we take the blinkers off and they see what their potential is as change agents, that they're embracing it. What are our patients saying?
I knew it was a heavy thing to dump on a student, but I think because it was the first time a clinician had been responsive to me and kind, I felt like I could tell her my story. I was worried that it might have been too much, but afterwards she told me she was thankful that I shared my experience with her and that it helped her to understand my journey.
Patient two.
It was probably one of the few health experiences that I had had that actually took a bit of time and was not treating me as an object. A lot of the healthcare system can do that. It was a good thing that the student did.
It was the first time a doctor got me.
This is actually one of the most pivotal quotes I've ever had from a Māori patient. This wasn't from a formal evaluation. This was, I was at the mall, and one of my husband's whanaka came up to me, and she gave me a big hug, and she said this to me. Now, the saddest thing about this quote is this whaia, or toa, had breast cancer, cardiovascular disease, had just recently had a double mastectomy, had been in the health system for over 30 years, and this was her comment. This was her comment about one of our Malaysian students who was in his first week of clinical practice. And I think that kind of saddened me, that we have, as a medical fraternity, sorority, whatever, health community been so unaccountable to our patients in the past, but a glimmer of hope that there's starting to be some change.
I enjoyed being able to help the student along the way, and she was pretty cool about that, and pretty understanding about what Māori do. I took my son's afterbirth and buried it facing the North Island, because that's where both his parents come from. So I explained why we keep the afterbirth and do that. Why we do karakia. She asked quite a lot of questions. When, why, is it for everyone or just for certain whānau? Does everyone do the same thing?
And what I loved about this is what I worked out in my research is actually a lot of our Māori patients are desperate to teach. And they see their roles as teaching our health professionals about their experience of being Māori, and it's so magic because it allows our students to see diversity in reality.
Yeah, when I have the opportunity. He was funny. He greeted me in te reo. He wasn't awkward at all. He was quite genuine.
Thank you. And that was in comparison to the senior doctor that they'd met just previously. So we think that was really good. And we're so grateful within our curriculum that our Māori community see themselves as part of our teaching team, not separate from our teaching team. and kind of we've put in different mechanisms to ensure that we capture their voices and that they are driving our curriculum. Now, what about our Māori House stakeholders? These are, for me, are always the scariest.
I often hear some of the senior consultants comment on how much more these new graduates know in terms of the knowledge of Māori House, more than they ever knew when they came through the system. I've noticed little things like the new graduates attempting to pronounce names correctly, Kurungatai, and understanding, that was a bit of an ad-lib, and understanding of simple procedures on dealing with whānau instead of just the patient. So I've noticed a steady improvement in competencies in working with Māori.
Kia ora. Just an update on the positives of the health day. All staff have written current stats, goals, and buddied up. We've shared training and kai one day a week, and we check in on our progress there.
This to me was a great success where, I think the key's here, so I won't doubt him, where some of my Māori House colleagues were part of the Māori Health Day, and pretty much my students told them they were fat. And instead of being offensive and coming to haunt me about that, they actually set together as a rōpū and set new goals and are on their own journey to hold it with that, which I think is pretty awesome.
I wasn't sure about that Asian student, but then they started doing whakawhanaukataka and using te reo, and they asked me about my whānau, and I was like, this is awesome.
So the other thing I've learned is also that we teach our students not to be racist to Māori, but I also have to kind of work out some strategies to how they deal with when our Māori patients go, so how do you cook rice properly? and kind of priming our students that racism is in different forms and informed by different ways, but not always delicious. But I think the Māori House stakeholders are really key to any of our curriculum, and even if you're not in health, I hope you're thinking about the area you're in, whether it's education or working with school communities. How do your colleagues that are outside of your immediate group rate you, and what can you learn from them? I love our Māori health workers. They tell me how it is all the time, and they keep me grounded. But the coolest thing about our Māori health workers within our hospitals is they see our students in real life. They see what they're doing on the wards. So it's another way of receiving feedback for us. Then what about our Māori Health teaching team? I work with great colleagues, both in here in Christchurch and also in Wellington and in Dunedin. And one of the biggest things that we have learnt as a Māori Health teaching team is how we deal with exposure to racism. How we deal with racist comments from students, from our colleagues, how we have to learn to have thicker skin if we want to be champions in this area, and it's not easy. And you have to have someone to have your back. I reiterate Simon's comments. Because actually trying to teach Māori health in isolation to a team means that we can't retain staff. And so if you are isolated, I'd really encourage you to make sure you make networks outside of your immediate environment so that you have this peer support. One of the more disturbing experiences we had of recent times was actually one of my colleagues was facilitating a small group work workshop that we do with our students at the beginning of clinical year at the Marae. And one of the students said to him, yes, when my mother found out I was coming to the Marae, she was really, really disturbed. And she said, I'm not going to let you go. Now our students are 22, they're not five. And her mum said, I'm not going to let you go to that Marae. There's no way you're going. And she went, Mum, I have to go. It's part of my compulsory course. And luckily she'd had awesome experiences with Joe Baxter. So she was like, I want to go to the Marae. And her mother goes, it's not safe for you to go to the Marae. You're going to get raped. That's what happened to people who go to Marae. And as a team, that was a very, very complicated. You know, there's things that you think you know, like you know that Arawa Maori's a fat, but you're all smart. You know, you get used to that racist discourse, but there is never a dull moment when something else didn't come. And the interesting thing is, the student didn't believe it, but it really assisted us to understand her context and actually what she was navigating at home to try and champion for Māori health. And that kind of racist discourse that existed in her family. And as a team, we actually had to have a debrief with that staff member because they were so thrown and weren't quite sure how to navigate themselves out of that commentary. Not that the student needed it, but actually as Indigenous staff, we just felt intensely sad. Mm. And I think that, unlike my, if I taught psychology, I would not be in tears near as much as I am in teaching Māori health. Because when you teach about Māori stuff, it's here, right? And it's here, it's not here. And so unlike our colleagues who teach epidemiology or who teach who teach psychiatry or other things, it's something external to them. But when you teach something that's here and here, and then people critique it, you have to be so much stronger. And you need a Māori Health teaching team, and you need to have good strategies. And we have predictive text. So we have text that, so when a student goes, but isn't that just because Mary's a genetically unable or got genetic issues, thrifty gene, we go, we look at each other like, ha ha ha, who's gonna answer that? Because we already have a predictive text on some of that racist commentary. But every now and again, like the other year, there's an odd comment that still throws out saying you need that support. And you need that support from your colleagues that this is a picture of some of us enjoying a nice sunset in Darwin, but from across the campuses really, really is important because I think the more diverse opinions you have and the more encouragement you get, it makes it easier to stay in the job being an Indigenous educator, and I think that is a challenge for Lincoln at the moment, which Simon talked about. What about my peers? Do you know that the institution would not give Hauora Māori any teaching time? So I made mates with a German respiratory physician. And he controls 2 weeks' timetable of the Hauora Māori curriculum. Of the whole curriculum. And because he doesn't like the colonial lens of the English either, he, to be disruptive, said, hey, I'll give you 2.5 days. Now this was unheard of because before this, I'd only got 1 hour in the 3 years. And so thanks to a random German who took me 3 years to understand his accent, he provided space in that and he comes to the marae with us every year. He teaches the students about colonisation, racism. He helps teach the content. He teaches them about how he applies the hui process and the meihana model in his own framework. He's a great champion for non-Māori to see a good role model. But he provided space, so not all non-Indigenous people are resistant. And for those that are resistant, we have to convert them. You know how I convert them? I take them to the Māori Health Days. Our kids are so freaking cute, they can't resist us. And working back in the community, in the Māori community, they get it. And they learn that they know, that they realise what they don't know. And that we have to engage them. We have to be marketers. We've got to sell that chicken and avocado burger to our heart's content, even if they're vegetarian. We have to make them think past their vegetarianism and want to embrace their chicken. And it's hard work, but it's important. And the good thing is that when we first started back at the marae, one of the top surgeons here in Christchurch wrote an official complaint and said, that is ridiculous. Students do not need 2.5 days of Māori health. They need 2.5 more days of surgery. Doesn't matter that they already get 8 weeks of it. And I was just very fortunate that actually what happened is in terms of systemic stakeholders that the dean at the time of my school didn't like surgeons, he wasn't one. And so often it's got nothing to do with us, it can be to do with their own crap. That he went, stuff those surgeons, you're not only having 2.5 days, damn it, you're having a week. And so sometimes champions come from places that we can't fight ourselves. And systemic stakeholders are really important. Because actually, you know what rules our social accountability within a system? I'm sure all tertiary institutions are like this, but timetabling time rules the planet, and resourcing of teachers rules the planet. So actually, I know that you're vegetarian. I know you've been vegetarian for 20 years, but I'm telling you, the chicken is awesome. It's more important with the systemic stakeholders, even sometimes more than the conveners. And the systemic stakeholders of our institutions can be harder to shift. But one thing that's really helped us is when you move the students and you move your non-Māori colleagues, then the system moves on its own sometimes. But sometimes the system can move and then your colleagues just have to get on board. And I'm sure we've all had different experiences of this. And we have gone from having, in our 3-year clinical program, from having one timetabled hour for Indigenous health to now having 72 hours over the 3 years. So we've had huge changes, but it's taken the buy-in and also the social accountability. So we had to convince our dean that actually being accountable to the people at Akarua, the, our Onuku Runaka, which is where we take our students, we had to get them to invest in that, to realise that was important. And when the new marae open, Wharekai opens in November, it will have two University of Otago teaching rooms in it, which I think is really pivotal systemic commitment from our organisation. So, my epiphany at the end of 4 long years of doing a PhD, if you want to go a little bit cray cray, you should do your PhD. It's an awesome space to do it in, and I acknowledge Catherine's here, Savage, who's one of my PhD supervisors. What I realised in my epiphany was social accountability isn't about cooking a burger and then going, eat it. Social accountability is about getting everyone together and going, hungry? What kind of burger do you want? Let's make that burger together. Let's make sure that all the ingredients that are in that burger, you're into it. And then it's about eating the burger together, implementing it together, having the kai together, then critiquing the kai, going, you know, too much relish, shouldn't have caramelized the onions. And then redoing the product so that when it comes to evaluation, you haven't fallen into the trap where you've just got Nanny Rangia and Papa Alf. And said to them, so we're good, eh? Because they're going, no, your kai sucks. Because they've actually been part of the whole process. And this truly is social accountability. So our patients and students inform the design, so does the convener. In terms of the implementation of the curriculum, the patients are part of the implementation. That's who our students are interviewing. The conveners are watching. The conveners are being challenged when our students write their gerontology project and then do a Māori analysis on it because the patient was Māori. And our colleagues are having to run to catch up to work out how they mark that analysis. And then in terms of the evaluation, it means everyone's at the table and everyone is a stakeholder in our Māori community and Māori health. Because if it's just Indigenous educators, if it's just us Māori health teachers that are concerned about Māori health, we're stuffed. Because really we need everybody to see that it's part of all of our mahi. And so social accountability isn't just on us, but it's on us to drive our students and our tertiary institutions and our Indigenous communities. Because if our Māori communities aren't invested in us either, there's a gap in our social accountability model. And you know what? We may end up with a vegetarian burger, because actually that's what all stakeholders see as important. I hope that day never happens personally, because I'm quite into my chicken and avocado. But we have to be willing to kind of move and change and to think about that. So in terms of the lessons that I've learned that I want to kind of leave as a key message today, is for Indigenous educators, I think it's so important for us to think about and to know we're not the only Māori in the village. And at any point that we find that we are, we need to either get out of that village or go and start just doing a tiki tour around the other villages. You know, even in Nuhaka, which has a population of, I think, 450, we have 5 marae within a 7k radius. Why? Because we are diverse. And every time we don't agree, we just build another marae and don't deal with that. And that's actually okay. And as Indigenous curriculum designers, we have to design curriculum that is inclusive of our whole Māori community, just not the ones that go to Matatini. You know, of all of them. And those that go to Matatini are fabulous, but there are others, like me, who's totally unco with the group. We also need to make sure that our students feel socially accountable, that they want to do better, that they don't want to, that they don't think it's your job or the Māori health worker's job to do it. That they see that it's their job to do it, their job to make change, their job to do correct Māori pronunciation, their job to access the right care, and their job to know how, some of our Māori health workers are quite passionate at good baking, what to bake to get the Māori health workers on site to help them out. And that's, I think, really, really key. And let me tell you, not all students are converts at the time. I had this particular student, you know, you only remember the stars and the hoohas. And I got this email in my email inbox, and I saw her name, and I was like, holy crap, I thought we got rid of her 3 years ago. She was that, she was hard work. And there's a whole lot of reasons why she was hard work that I think were around her context, and that we were pulling her out of her comfort zone and she didn't want to go. And she wrote me an email that said, you probably don't remember me. But I was one of the annoying ones in the back that used to protest about having so much Māori health time and not wanting to do the exams and not wanting to write your assignments. And she went on to share an experience that she had in Taranaki Hospital. And she talked about that all the other doctors, so she was a graduated doctor by this time, took a step back. And they're like, this Māori patient and their whānau are too hard. And she said she knew at that point that she actually did know how to do it. And she got in there and she did it. And she said, I'm really sorry, but actually everything you taught me was true. Funny that. And they never believed me at the time, did they? But she said, I'm sorry. And I realise now the value of it, and actually I wish I had twice as much time. And for me, that was quite heartening, because there are some days as an Indigenous health educator that you think, oh, stuff this is too hard. I'm going to go to the Whare Whānau Aotearoa and do a degree in weaving. Get my health better. You know, and it's just moments and glimpses like that you actually see not only the translation of your teaching, but the transformation of your teaching. And I think that's what keeps most of us in the game. And for tertiary institutions, I think it has, for me, realised we... and I like Sasha talked about not just fighting the institution, but actually working and finding joy in the institution so you can remain there. Mm. And so, yes, some of us are in quite racist institutions, but there's also gaps in that institution that allow some development, and I think we have to grab that. And for our Indigenous communities, I love them. You know, Ngāi Tahu isn't in law. Lucky I bred for them, so they're very inclusive of me. They hold me accountable. And I am grateful that recently here in Christchurch, Mr. Vino, I didn't ask to be part of Matatini or to work those hours in the tent, but we were asked by our community to do it. And how wonderful to take my students into Matatini, and they worked 12-hour shifts, bless them. Nothing to do with assessment, nothing to do with getting a grade. They did it because they get it, and that was so rewarding. And we're grateful that we had a photo op with Sir Mark, just to keep the real boss and the big boss happy, but also to just have be acknowledged by Mark to come to the tent and spend some time and see what we were doing. I don't know if he was checking up or reinforcing our behaviour, but I think it provided my colleagues and I a great opportunity to feel a new passion for this work and to keep holding in there. And my challenge to you is to think about social accountability broader than just you back to your whānau, you back to your institution. Think about how it drives your curriculum, how it drives your outcomes, and how it drives your impact. Kia ora.